Hi, I'm Christine Potis-Larsen. I'm the president of Public Art St. Paul, and I'm here today, June 21st, at the site of the St. Paul International Stone Carving Symposium. We're on the lawn of the St. Paul College, right near the intersection of Kellogg and Summit. For the past weeks, since the 22nd of May, 14 stone sculptors from all over the world have gathered here to carve sculptures from big blocks of Minnesota stone. Today, we're going to take a look at how the artists are progressing, and we're going to hear from Dennis Martin, a geologist with the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources, who's going to tell you a lot about the composition of what makes Minnesota rock. Joining me today, as he has over the last several weeks, is Mark Wickstrom. Mark Hello. Is the apprenticeship coordinator for the Bricklayers and Allied Trades of Minnesota and North Dakota, and himself a European-trained master stone carver. Mark, what are we going to do today?
Well, I think we're going to start out. We're going to talk to Sakari because we really haven't had an extended interview mm-hmm. with him. Mm-hmm. And we're going to go around and check the progress of the other artists. And there's been some tremendous progress being made. A couple of the artists are actually close to finishing. So.
Yes, it's really exciting to see the results. We hope that everyone will take an opportunity to come here over the next week and a half. We close on June 30th, so you have 1.5 weeks to come to the lawn of the St. Paul College. We're open daily from noon to 8 p.m., and we hope you'll join us for the closing ceremony on June 30th at 4 o'clock. We also hope that you will see the College of Visual Arts Gallery's exhibition of the works by these 14 artists, a special display at Selby and Western. But for now, let's go take a look at the wonderful work of the artist from Finland, Sakari Peltola. Let's go, Mark.
Yep, let's go. Oh boy, Sakari. Well, we've moved down here in the work area a little further with Sakari, and we're going to talk to him a little bit about his progress on his piece. Could you tell us a little bit about how it's going for you right now?
So far. I got my cloud over there. Mm-hmm. On the base, it went quite well. Uh-huh. And then I'm working with this other piece.
Okay.
This work is two pieces.
Okay. Could you explain a little bit about the principle, the theory behind your work, and what this piece represents?
This is a quite simple form. This basic, like a cloud form up there, but it's going to St. Anthony. You know, there's a new park mm-hmm. they built it, and it's a beautiful place. It's going to the top of the hill. This cloud and this. Figure comes under the hill, so there's connection of these two sculptures.
Now, I think I heard you earlier refer to this guy as a weatherman.
Weatherman, yes.
Okay.
If you have a cloud, you have to have a weatherman.
You have to have somebody to interpret that cloud. Yeah.
I think the dialogue here is who is this weatherman? I don't know, but everybody talking about weather in here, yeah. Minnesota, like we do in Finland and
all over the world. It's
all
universal.
Over the world, it is like that. And but it has been quite nice. Now I think I leave this cloud like this. It's a simple form, what you can see mm-hmm. far away, and of course this weatherman, it's coming slowly. Uh-huh. Maybe I have to work it in this week, so it. Next week it'll be more like finishing things.
You've got a beautiful texture going on the body of this weatherman. That's very ingenuity.
Yeah, I would like a little bit play with this because there was a different kind, but they are, you know, 10, 15, 20 meters apart, mm-hmm. but you can see them both. So I want to do something else here. And. Yeah, a little bit like this, and mm-hmm. we'll see what it's going to be.
Looking at your work, it seems like you like to tease the audience with all kinds of different textures that work together in your piece, and that's really nice to see.
Yeah, now I think about this cloud, I have to see it now in next week, or look about it. Uh-huh. When the sun comes around, you can see different uh-huh. spots or different places over there. And maybe fix little bit fixing, but I think it's quite ready.
Yeah, that's one thing that we run into in the skilled trades too, is the ultimate judge is the light. Because the light doesn't lie, it will tell you if there's a fault in anything, and it often helps a sculptor too to adjust his work. Have you given a name to your weatherman yet?
No, it's only weatherman.
Only weatherman, okay.
Golden cloud or yellow cloud and weatherman.
Okay. Well, we want to let you get back to work, and we want to thank you for your time. We know you're a busy man.
Yeah. I have to make this in this week, so, and we have these lectures today.
Okay.
So it's a 5 o'clock, it's quite a short day. But
short day, yeah.
Tomorrow is another one. There's plenty of time, but slowly, slowly.
Yep. Okay. Well, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Yep.
Yeah.
Moved on over in the work site, and we're here with Lazarus Takawira, and he's agreed to give us a few minutes to talk about his progress and his piece. How are you doing, Lazarus?
I'm all right, and you, Mike?
Good, good. Everything's going good.
Very good.
Could you tell us a little bit about how you feel about your progress at this point? Everything going well?
Oh yeah, everything is going well. I don't have any complaint. Everything is going well.
Could you tell us a little bit about your piece?
The title of my sculpture is called Too Much in My Head. And that's the title of my sculpture, and I'm doing it in a stone called Dolomite.
I heard from somebody else that occasionally your wife helps you out with some of your projects. She's kind of encouragement. What's it been like working on this project without your wife here?
Well, I'm just saying to everybody, my sculpture is not yet finished. I'm waiting for my wife to come. I'm coming next year. So she's going to show me some of which I've missed. And she's going to tell me, I want you to do A, B, C, D. Then I can do it. Yes, that's what I'm waiting for. Yes, my sculpture is not yet finished.
Could you tell us about any kind of special experiences you've had since you've been here with the symposium?
My experience to this place was I managed to meet quite different artists from abroad, like Italy, Germany, Egypt, and whatsoever. And some of the guys are here from America. It was a very good experience to come up with different artists. You know, you've got some new ideas coming, and they were very helpful, especially into my Shona sculpture. I would rather say to myself, this sculpture is finished, but into the modern now, it's not yet finished, because we don't work together with modern and my Shona sculpture. For instance, I'm doing all my sculpture by hand. So it means I've already done, because somebody cannot understand my work, because it's not really open to people. Some cannot see it, but some will see it. And some people are saying it's beautiful sculpture. And some are not saying, I think it's not yet finished.
Well, that's a part of your style, to work with the hand tools, and obviously it's going to take a lot longer to get anything done with the hand tools.
Oh, yeah, yes. Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
But, yeah, we're glad you took a few minutes to explain to us what's going on in your corner of the symposium. Mm-hmm. And it's a big kind of push for the last week here coming up. And
sure.
Yeah.
The last week is coming. Uh-huh. Yeah, the last week is coming, and we are hoping to... Well, I managed to create quite a number of friends, mm-hmm. Including you, Mark. You're part of my friend too, and I'm happy to see different people here all together, and they love the art, and we got at least, I don't know how many, money to visit us.
Well, I've often told our apprentices that if you pay attention in your career, in your quest, that you often become part of the people around you.
Oh yeah, yes.
When they have a profound effect on you, and a symposium like this, you guys are obviously going to be taking some things away from each other when you go back to your homeland, that memories,
yes.
At least.
Oh yeah, yes. Oh, quite mm-hmm. a number of interesting stories. You know, we've got this guy from Japan by the name Atsua. Mm-hmm. He does his things in a manner that you can't understand it properly until he shows you. If you come across to his sculpture, just say, what is this? And you don't even understand how to lead it, but if he tells you, you'll be satisfied and you don't even ask him again.
Mm-hmm. Well, we want to thank you for taking the time to talk to us today.
Thank you.
We'll be back next week to talk to you again.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lazarus.
Thank you.
Maybe different words, I think.
Mm. Oh.
A kind of not perfect, you know.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah. Just so enjoying.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah, this kind of feeling. Yeah, mm. I like. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyway, I like a cat.
Mm-hmm.
And because dog, of course, I like dog.
Mm-hmm.
But dog is always belongs to the human, mm-hmm. man.
Yeah.
Always follow the man or something. But yeah. Cat is never followed the yeah. man. Just feel free feeling.
Cats are independent.
Independent, yes.
Yes, they can take or leave humans, that's
yes,
for sure.
Yeah. And this cat is independent in the park. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, we came down here with Atsuo Okamoto, and he's telling us a little bit about his piece. You're pretty much done with your main piece that you
yeah.
came here to do.
Yeah.
And we were just talking about, he's got a little side project here. He said he was getting bored, so he got a piece of scrap from one of the other artists, and he actually carved this cat.
Yeah.
And have you given the cat a name?
Tom?
Plum?
No, it's a joke, you know.
Oh, yeah,
if
oh, yeah.
I make a small mouse,
oh, yeah.
it's a Jerry.
Jerry, Tom
and Jerry.
Oh, okay, I see.
But it's a joke.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Very interesting. And you basically did this piece out of just recreational carving, basically. Just having fun, correct?
Pardon?
Just having fun.
Just before?
No, for this piece here. I mean, just, you love to carve, and
yes,
this
yes.
was just to...
Yes, just enjoy.
To enjoy,
to
yeah.
enjoy, no responsibility,
yep.
This kind of feeling.
Oh, yeah.
Just I like to make, just make.
Just make,
yeah.
just to create. Yeah, perhaps we could go over here by your main piece and talk about that, and tell us a little bit about what's behind it. What was, could you explain to us a little bit about the principle of the piece, and now that it's completed? And
yeah, I got many pavement stone.
Yeah,
already used.
Okay.
And from the city side.
Okay.
And there some pieces from the stone company near here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but mainly I got city.
Okay.
And I already finished, and I put into inside the new memory.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. It's a little difficult to explain, but yeah.
So you've got mortar underneath here, underneath the stones.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then you wanted to give the appearance of having a very tight joint, because I've seen your other work. You like to work with that very tight precision.
Yeah.
Very small space between a stone where it's almost dry.
Yeah.
So this mosaic here, for lack of a better word, of these rubble stone and old brick pavers and multiple types of stone in here is replicating the shape of the other piece over here. I talked to Otsuo when he was first starting out, and he basically spent about a week and a half, 2 weeks, cutting the depth down in this piece to mirror this piece.
Yes, yes. And yesterday I make a letter, EXIT.
Oh, a letter. Okay.
Yeah.
So there's a hidden message in this piece too.
All right.
Exit.
And the other side is entrance.
Entrance. Okay.
But I didn't make a letter.
Uh-huh.
I don't want to make a letter.
Okay.
Just feel. The feeling is entrance of memory. It's that stone, and this stone is coming out. It's a kind of exit.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's the travel of an idea, basically,
yeah,
from an entrance to an exit.
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's my interpretation of it. But anyway, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us, and we're going to be back next week to talk to you some more.
Yeah.
And we'll see what other kind of surprises we have down here that you've created. So,
okay.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Well, if you come down to the symposium, we have a tent set up down here, and there's a lot of really good information about natural stone in Minnesota. And I drug out one of these easels with a map, one of the maps, of explaining where the deposits are and how old approximately they are. And there's some words in here that may be a little fuzzy for me. So I would like to bring in a specialist that we have with us today. We have a special guest, Dennis Martin. Dennis, come on in. Welcome to the symposium.
Yes. Well, the rocks here in Minnesota, we've got all kinds and all ages.
Uh-huh.
We have sedimentary rocks, the limestones, that are about 400 million years old.
Mm-hmm.
We've got 1.1 billion year old igneous rocks where molten magma is cooled underground.
Mm-hmm.
We've got rocks that formed along the shoreline as sediments and then were metamorphosed.
Mm-hmm.
We usually think of those as the taconite mine.
Yeah.
The rocks that are being mined in the taconite mines. And then in between, we've got 1.8 billion year old granites that cooled underground, magmas that cooled underground. Even way out in Ortonville, we have those granites that we can see here, take a look at.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, interesting. Well, should we take a look around and see what kind of samples we could highlight, and you could give us a brief description of what we see?
Sounds good.
Starting right here, we've got some limestone, and I believe this is Kasota limestone. You want to tell us a little bit about it?
Yep. So these formed as sediments in an ocean that came into the continent here.
Uh-huh.
The Twin Cities area has the same sedimentary rocks, limestone, sandstone, shales. So these are a very common rock. They come in these beautiful different colors that we're gonna see here today, but generally limestones formed in the ocean.
And the building block for those limestones is calcium based
calcium
material.
Calcium carbonate. Yeah, just like we see forming in the oceans today.
Let's look at some other pieces we have here.
Could you tell us a little bit, perhaps, about this
one? We moved up to an ancient shoreline about 1.8 billion years ago, when an ocean was up at where we think of the Mesabi Iron Range now.
Uh-huh.
And this one probably shows us metamorphosed fossils, believe it or not. I mean, that's what these may be showing us here. But part of the muds that formed along an ancient ocean shoreline that have been metamorphosed into very hard rocks.
This this looks like a real hard material. What would you say its hardness was comparative to, let's say, granite?
Harder.
Harder than granite.
Harder than granite, yep.
I know, yep. There's a scale of hardness, a Mohs scale of hardness, and you know, one being the softest material like talc or chalk, and 10 being the hardest known of diamond. I know granite can come in at about an 8, so you're saying this could possibly be a 9 on that scale?
Well, no, but generally these rocks have a greater content of chert, a type of quartz.
Yep.
And it's the quartz that in these rocks is generally really giving them the hardness, I think.
Okay, yep. All right. Well, let's move on. Let's see what else we can find out down here. It looks like we have a piece of Virginia slate. Can you tell us a little bit about slate and how it's formed?
Sure. Again, up along the Iron Range, about 1.8 billion years ago, there was an ocean shoreline there. Uh-huh. We know the shoreline was very near to Calumet because we can find fossils in the Calumet area, for example. But this is the mud that sank to the bottom of the ocean a little bit deeper offshore from the shoreline, and the muds were later metamorphosed and formed this Virginia formation, is what we call it.
Okay. Now, whenever we talk about a metamorphic rock, can we be fair to say that it's heat, pressure, and time that are involved?
Yes, that's okay. Right. Yep.
Well, we're gonna travel down and talk over there with Craig David, and we'll look at a piece of granite that he's working on.
Okay.
All right, we've run across a couple people visiting the symposium here today, and it's Tom Scheller and
that's right,
his brother Jim Scheller.
That's right. Nice to meet you.
And we figured we'd stop them and ask them of their impression of the symposium. Can you guys tell us what you think of the event so far?
This is my second time down here.
Great.
I'm just really impressed and amazed by how it changes.
Mm-hmm. He dragged me along today. He said, "You got to see this. It is astounding." Yeah, I'm amazed that all this stone came from this region, isn't that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's impressive. And also, how the heck did they get them in here?
Mm-hmm.
And how do they move all the material? Mm-hmm. And the other thought I have is, how the heck did Michelangelo do it without the power tools?
Well, that's a testament to his real talent.
I think so.
And dedication.
Yeah, it's wonderful to see people from all over the world. I saw a fellow from Africa, fellow from Germany over here, yeah. Finland, I think.
Yep.
Italy,
wonderful.
And they're great to talk to. They're just really informative. And
I'm a woodworker. I sculpt wood, and I'm inspired now. I'm thinking about going out and digging up some rock.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, there's a lot of people that come down here to the symposium, and they watch these artists, and they say, well, I could never do that. But I encourage people all the time. I think everyone's an artist. You just got to find out what you're an artist at.
Yeah, these guys are the real thing, though, working with red granite.
Oh, yeah.
Patience. If you don't have it to begin with, you'll have it when you're done.
Oh, yeah. And just one more question before we go. We've got to move down and talk with Dave and Craig.
Oh, yeah.
Are you guys local here out of St. Paul, or are you from outside St. Paul? Or?
Como boys.
Okay.
What are we, three all generations, right. I think, yeah. Right. Or so?
So you guys are right in the neighborhood.
Yeah. We're from
St.
Paul.
We're home.
Okay.
It's great to have this here.
Yeah. Well, thanks for talking to us, and enjoy your time at the symposium.
Okay,
thanks
a lot.
See
ya.
Mr.
Hey,
Mark.
How you doing?
Good to see you.
Well, we've moved down here with Craig David. And he's taking on another part of his project. He's actually working on some granite. And Craig, I wanted you to meet a special guest I brought along with me today. He's a geologist.
Good.
Dennis Martin.
Nice to meet you.
Nice meeting you.
And I'd like you guys to talk a little bit about, well, first off, what you're doing with this piece here. You're going to make some benches, I understand?
Yes. Yeah. Well, it's kind of interesting because a couple days ago, this was, we've got four pieces here. They were all one large piece of stone. And so we've split in half, and then this has been split into thirds. So number one and number three stone here will become benches. This is a piece we'll use later on for something else. And they're just getting, the tops are just getting finished basically, and they'll go with the piece of stratified taconite that I was working on earlier.
This has got to be soft after working with that stratified.
Yeah, it's soft, but you know, I'm getting tired, so.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. It's still
not
pretty,
that soft.
It's still pretty substantial, so yeah. But it is, at least you can move it. The piece of iron over there, you could hardly budge it, you know, so yeah, this is a nice change.
So Dennis, could you tell us a little bit about the piece that...
it looks like this came from Ortonville. Is that what they told you?
You know, I really have no clue,
yeah,
so...
Yeah, this looks like a granite from Ortonville. And again, that'd be about 1.8 billion years old. We're talking about old rock here. We're talking about a time when the North American continent wasn't as big as it is now. Southern Minnesota crashed into a plate, crashed into the northern half of Minnesota. And these granites are molten magma that came up through the crust, deep in the crust. They crystallized deep underground, miles and miles underground. So we have large crystals on these that you can see in the sunlight here.
Sure.
Very homogeneous rock.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the story on this granite. Very different than the limestone that we looked at before.
Oh, yeah. It's a beautiful stone. I mean, it really splits very well and behaves itself fairly well, you know. So, and that's probably what you mean by homogeneous. You know, it's got some real continuity throughout. So, yeah, I'm enjoying working on it, I can say that.
Pretty predictable.
Fairly predictable and, you know, wonderful color. Which,
oh, beautiful,
which is what I like about it. It's probably the prettiest stone here, so.
Yeah. And if you could explain to us, Craig, I guess it was quite an attraction when you did split that block. You had the whole camp here basically lined up watching for this big half of the block to fall off, didn't you?
Yeah, it's been an interesting experience watching others split stone, and this is the first stone I've ever split, and so
really?
I had a lot of coaching. Mm-hmm. From some of the other guys, Atsuo Akimoto and a friend of his, Jesse from Maine, and Saki from Finland, are all big stone splitters. They split a lot of stones. That's one of the primary ways of working in, when they create sculpture.
Mm-hmm.
And so they coached me through the whole thing, and it's funny because when people see sculptors and others and visitors see that someone is splitting a stone, they all start to gather, and we had quite a crowd on Sunday.
I bet you did.
Yeah, it was pretty exciting.
Mm-hmm. Could you just tell us a little bit about, I know it's a special set of tools you have to use when you're working the granite. You have some carbide inserts in some of these chisels and bushing heads.
Yeah, I think these are some hammers here, Mark. I think they're just steel.
Okay, that looks like steel.
Yeah, right? I'm not sure that there's any carbide in that, but there's diamond tools for your for doing your sawing. This is a diamond composition in an emulsion on a saw blade. And this is a cup wheel here. That also, you can see the little, maybe you can see the little particles within an emulsion here. And those are diamonds that are harder than the granite, harder than the stone. And so they remove the material. And that's pretty much how it's done, other than the good old hammer and chisel. That's another way you can do it. So,
well, we want to thank you for taking the time to explain that to us and taking time to speak with Dennis a little bit.
Yeah, thanks, Dennis.
Thank you.
Appreciate you coming by. I heard the story on that one from a state geologist. Do you work for the state, too? Yeah, I don't remember what the gal's name was, but she was very informative. I'd like to hear your story, too, because you never know. You might... Here a little flux. You want to go over and just talk about that stone? I'm curious what Dennis has to say about it. She said this was a sedimentary stone, metamorphized, you know.
That's right. She had that part right. The age date, though, it really is 1.8 billion to 1.9 billion in that age.
So it's as old as the granite, or older.
That's correct. Yep, it is. Yep. this material is came out of a taconite mine.
Yeah.
And the reason that this one is more metamorphosed and more beautiful perhaps than some of the other pieces in mines that are west of this location is that there was molten magma nearby that was extremely hot, and the hot temperatures in what we call the Duluth Igneous or Duluth Gabbro complex, right nearby to this stone, miles away, 5 miles away maybe.
Okay.
The hot waters and the hot temperatures heated this up.
Okay.
It actually changed some of these minerals.
Okay.
And so we see the beautiful reds and greens in here along with the whites. The steel gray shows, we can easily see the magnetite minerals, the steel gray that has the iron ore in it.
Okay.
And then we have the jasper in the reds here. We have a number of different minerals in the green.
Someone was saying that the red may have been an algae bloom at one time. Is that possible, or?
Well, we can be a little more specific than that. The red often shows up in what are called stromatolites that are referred to as algae. But the red is really a hematite, an iron mineral, and those stromatolite fossils, and we're going to look at those on another rock over here. They can be any color. They can be yellow, they can be green, they can be red. The metamorphism colors those. It hardens them and colors them, but they can be any color. The red is a mineral. Yep.
Great stuff.
Yep.
Okay, well, thanks for that explanation.
Thank you, guys.
And,
right.
We're going to head down the line.
Appreciate your talking about it.
All right.
I love that stone. So.
We've moved over to Lei's station here, our Chinese artist, and we've got somebody along with us today to help translate, Nancy.
Hi.
Thanks, Nancy,
yeah,
for
no
doing
problem.
That for us. We'd like to ask a few questions of Lei, and starting out, I guess, how does he feel as far as his progress? Is he almost finished? Or?
He asked you, "Are you almost finished? How are you doing? How are you doing? How are you doing? How are you doing?
How are you doing? How are you doing? How are you doing? How are you doing? How are
Yeah, he said he's you know, almost finished. He's mainly on the final just stages of just fixing some details and mainly just the minor details.
Yeah, I saw you were grinding up some stone. Are you're actually kind of patching in some little pock marks in the stone, I believe. Is that what he was doing?
Yeah, he had like a minor hole
just in the
cheek area, so he I think opened up the hole a little bit bigger and then just put a scrap piece of in there to fix that.
Could you ask him how his experience has been during the symposium? Is he satisfied with what's occurred here? And
他问你就是你这一个月时间你满意吗？就是你来美国这经验你觉得怎么样？我非常满意，非我是非常满意感到，因为
这是在我的人生中间是一个重要的经历。
He said he's really satisfied coming here, and this has been a really good experience.
I heard him tell someone else that he's used to working with a crew of people, and he's found that he's had to do the bulk of work himself, so he's tired from that.
Yeah, this is the first time where he's had to do all the work himself, and then because this is, you know, all new tools, and he's had to get used to that too, so he's been, you know, tired a lot of the times.
Well, he's done a phenomenal job. It's the way the light plays off of his piece is very interesting. And could you ask him if he has a name, or if he could tell us about the thought behind the piece?
他说你这刻这个头像是有什么意义后在后边？
我就是表现东西方的一种美，主要是把东方的美介绍到西方来，然后把中国的传统的手法和西方的 这个石头结合在一块。
Basically just combining, the face, you know, of a Eastern woman,
okay.
And you know, using kind of a Western stone. So the combination of the two put together.
Okay. I see. Yep. I see. Yeah. Interesting. Well, we want to thank you for your time. Thank you for your time. For letting us talk to you and ask you a few questions, and we'll be back next week to talk with you and wrap up.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you.
Thanks.
我的最后补一下。
你大概多久时间才能走？
等一下就可以走啊。
多久？
We came down here with Peter Morales. He's working on yet another animal here, it looks like. One flipped upside down on its back.
Yeah.
But I wanted to stop you just for a minute. We've got a special guest here today. We've got Dennis Martin. Dennis,
hi, Peter.
This is
Peter
Morales.
Nice to meet you.
And, you know, you're working on such an interesting stone over there. We thought maybe we could go down there and talk about it a little bit.
Sure.
Because we've got the expert here to explain it.
Okay. Yeah, there's a lot of events chronicled in the stone, and I don't think I know them all.
Okay, well, this is a piece of iron formation from northern Minnesota, about 1.8 billion years old, and generally there are many layers in the iron formation. It was deposited as mud near the shore of an ancient ocean. The ocean was full of iron. But what's special about the eye here is that we can see a very good example of a stromatolite fossil. And there actually are many of them, but this one, about the size of my finger, is very clear, and it shows the layers as a cross section in the fossil, as layers of algae might form today in the ocean. And there are many of them shown up in different colors, reds, this one is white, and yellows here. And what I thought was spectacular was in the mouth, there are teeth. There's a line of stromatolites, a layer of them, that looks just like teeth all the way across the mouth.
Yeah.
And I thought that was great.
Yeah. So what accounts for the difference in colors?
Well, it looks like metamorphism that happened later had hot waters moving through the rock. And the hot waters change the minerals.
Right.
So very micro, microchemical reactions that occurred from area to area caused the different minerals to form, and each mineral is a different color.
Okay.
The red we know is a certain type of hematite, a mineral called hematite.
Oh, it is hematite.
Yes, it's hematite in quartz.
Okay.
Referred to as jasper.
Jasper. Okay. Mm-hmm. And, but is there like pure hematite in this stone too?
Very little. There is some pure hematite. We saw magnetite and probably a little bit of hematite with that in a rock over in the middle there.
Okay.
But not here. We don't see that here. This rock looks like it has more of the silicate minerals in it and not much of the iron oxides.
Right. Well, so, speaking of that, you think we could move on down to Peter Stone he's working on now and talk a little bit about that one with him?
Sure.
Yeah, let's head over there.
So this one's a little bit easier to work on.
A little softer, yeah. I've been using the same blade for about a week, and I'll probably be able to use it for the rest of the year.
Compared to how many blades on the other piece?
I was using up a blade a day on that other stone.
Sediments from the bottom of the ocean, and these are about 1.4 billion years younger than those ocean sediments, and not nearly as metamorphosed. This is made up, most of this rock is made up of limestone or calcium carbonate, and that particular mineral is much softer than the minerals in the iron formation.
So it is slightly metamorphosed.
Waters, groundwaters moving through the rock have introduced some magnesium oxide in with the calcium oxides and the calcium carbonates here. So There is a little bit of dolomite in this rock. And yep.
So it's somewhere between sedimentary and into metamorphic. Okay.
All right. There's a layer about 10 feet thick in this part of Minnesota that the quarries use for these large blocks like this. Okay. And so if you can just imagine only a 10-foot layer that they're selecting out to make these products, that's what we're looking at.
Yep. We're not going to run out soon, are we?
No.
I hope not. Well, again, we want to thank you for coming down, Dennis. We understand you have to head out, but you've been a tremendous wealth of information.
Nice to meet you, Peter.
Nice talking to you.
All right.
Thanks. We'll see you.
And Peter, if you'd like to tell us just a little bit about this piece.
Yeah, so with these two animals, I'm making four-legged creatures, and like that one in the beginning, I started with a piece upside down. So this is upside down right now, so I can work on the legs and the belly. And then next Monday, it's going to get turned around, and then I'll work on the top. And you know, the working with reptiles or amphibians, kind of making a reference to, you know, the time, you know, going back in time when the rock was formed. And so these animals are associated with earlier life forms. Somebody described that other animal form as something that's emerging from the primordial ooze. Mm-hmm. And that's literally what it is.
Yep.
It's petrified primordial ooze.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah. And what's interesting also about the stromatolite was that those organisms were producing oxygen. Prior to the existence of these organisms, there was no oxygen in the atmosphere. So that allowed for life as we know it to exist.
Before we had plants and trees and all.
Plants and all that. And so, exactly. So you know, these four-legged creatures are kind of fanciful, but they're also playing around with the idea of life emerging, you know, from the rock.
So being that this stone is a lot softer, are you planning on expanding quite a bit on the detail that you're going to put into the piece?
I think when I turn it around, I'm going to be able to do a smoother finish on the top. Maybe not on this side of it, because you won't really be able to see it from close up. You'll see it from a distance, this shape. But the top, I'm going to be doing a lot more grinding and even getting a hone on it, and you'll be able to see the stone.
So you'll throw
a lot better
different
finishes on it and different textures too.
Well, yeah. Thanks for taking the time to speak with us.
Oh, thanks
and
for stopping by.
Good luck on your second piece.
Oh, thank you.
And we'll check back with you next week.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Yeah, we ran into Abe out here at the site, the symposium site, and Abe, how you doing? Abe is the site manager. Could you tell us a little bit about what you've observed here at the symposium?
First of all, I'd like to say I'm just grateful for the opportunity to be out here every day with the artists, and I really couldn't ask for a better job this summer. I've really enjoyed all the experiences I've had and all the relationships I've made out here. Can we edit that out?
No, that's all right. We'll keep rolling. You'll think of it, but I also wanted to mention that Abe's got another guest down here. He's a brother. And I'll have Alex come in here. And Alex, I actually know Alex from the apprenticeship. Alex is in our apprenticeship program. And why don't you tell us a little bit about how you feel about the event?
I think it's a great opportunity to just come down here and watch artists at work. I've been coming down here just helping Abe. We've been doing a lot of just site cleanup, just helping these artists get what they need, and basically just support, site support. And I don't know, I normally, I'm a bricklayer, stonemason, but I don't know. I just thought it'd be a great opportunity to take a week off of work and come down here and check out the artist's work.
And I've been talking in previous weeks about inspiring people to look at art in a different way, and I think you're one of those people that's within our ranks of a trade that you definitely have mentioned that you'd be interested in delving into some of these things like carving and the more artistic vein of it. So we're glad you're down here.
Definitely. Thanks for having me.
Oh yeah, no problem. And then we've got somebody else here. Kim, you want to come in?
Sure, yeah.
Kim, what is your function here at this site?
Well, my official title is the Information Wrangler. I've been working at the office with Christine Potis-Larsen, the President of Public Art, for a little over a year now. Mm-hmm. So.
Is that information pretty hard to wrangle? It sounds like you should have chaps on and a cowboy hat and the whole bit.
Well, sometimes it's a little bit harder than others, but it's been a great privilege working for Public Art.
So, were you involved with getting the international artists here at all and that kind of thing?
I had to wrangle some plane tickets and travel information, stuff like that. That got a little bit complicated.
Yeah, there's a lot of work that goes on behind the scenes that people don't really appreciate or really understand. And here you're looking at Kim is one of those people that does those things in the background that that make everything happen. So what do you feel about the symposium?
Well, I feel really privileged to be a part of this. I had no idea coming into it how big and wonderful it was going to be. It's been great, like getting to know each of the artists and how individual they are and their unique artistic styles and their personalities. It's just been amazing. So,
well, thanks for taking the time
to share some
comments with us, and we're going to be moving on.
Okay.
Thanks
thank
again.
You.
And I'm the one of the coordinators, one of the organizers, and I couldn't do a big project because can't organize and site manage and do a big project. So I'm working on a small work project for a client. It's going to be a headstone for two sisters. It's going to be set in a cemetery in Nova Scotia, in Cape Breton Island in Nova Scotia. And I'm going to start cutting letters probably either tomorrow or on Saturday. So if you come next week, I'll be cutting letters by hand or with air tools, but they're not being sandblasted. This is the script is going to be a sort of an old English script, a sort of a Gaelic-inspired script. The family is has of Scottish origin, Jamie Cloyd, my client, his wife was Mary McAvoy, who was killed in the plane crash with Paul Wellstone, and I've known him for maybe 8 or 10 years, and he commissioned me to do this headstone for his wife and his wife's sister, who died about 10 months before she did. And it will set at the grave site like this, so this will face up, So the colors are very beautiful. So when I polish it, if you and pour water on it, you get a sense of what it will look like when it's polished. So it won't be quite as dark and as red as this, but it will be very close to this, and then the text will be cut in. The text will either look white against the colors, or if we decide to paint it black, it will be black against the colors, but that hasn't been decided yet.
We've got an opportunity to come down here and meet with Mike Panizio. And how you doing, Mike?
Good.
Looks like you're washing off your stone a little bit, kind of stepping back and looking at your progress.
Yeah.
Could you tell us where you're at, really, with your stone right now and how you feel?
I think I'm done carving it.
You are? Okay.
I can kind of take... I'm started polishing now.
Uh-huh.
And in that process of polishing, I can think about that as long as I want, whether or not I'm going to put any more carving in it.
For the people at home, what takes longer, the polishing or the carving?
The polishing, I think.
Yeah, polishing. Yeah. I was going to guess that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like you have to put in your hours.
Well, it's been quite an afternoon here on the lawn of the St. Paul College as you've had a look at the progress of Minnesota Rocks, the St. Paul International Stone Carving Symposium. You've had a chance to meet more of the artists, to keep track of how their works are progressing, and even to meet the geologist with the State Department of Natural Resources to learn about Minnesota Rocks. Mark, how was Dennis? What did he say?
Oh, Dennis shed a bunch of brand new light on some of these stones. Uh-huh. We learned a tremendous amount of information from him, and it really was good to hear from an expert. He spent quite a bit of time over with Peter on the stromatolite. We learned a lot about stromatolite today, and it was really a great asset to have him here.
It's just wonderful, and you can tell that Dennis and others like him are just passionate about rocks. Mm-hmm. We hope that you'll take advantage of the next week and a half to come to the site of the symposium and watch the artists in the final stages of these wonderful public artworks. We're open from noon to 8 daily, and we hope you'll join us for our closing ceremony on Friday, June 30th at 4:00, right here at the St. Paul College. Thank you, Minnesota Rocks.